Welcome, everyone, to our next installment of the Christian Literary Imagination Series. We're delighted to have you all joining us from around the world, presumably some in Oxford, some in and around Georgetown, and some hopefully from Creighton University in Omaha, Nebraska, as everyone knows, the cultural and geographic center of the United States. Today, I'm very pleased to welcome Dr. Bridget Keegan, whose professional excellence and Irish warmth I enjoyed while I was teaching philosophy at Creighton University for a year about 8 years ago as part of my Jesuit formation. Dr. Keegan has been professor of English at Creighton University, and since 2013, she has served as the Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences. She received her Bachelor of Arts in Literature from Harvard University and her PhD in Comparative Literature from SUNY, that is the State University of New York at Buffalo. Her areas of scholarly and teaching interest include 18th century British literature, environmental literature, and Catholic writers. She has written and edited numerous books and published over 40 essays, many devoted to the work of laboring class authors. At Creighton, Dr. Keegan was instrumental in the design and launch of Creighton's Kingfisher Institute for the Liberal Arts and Professions, which supports innovative curriculum and interdisciplinary research. She's also won the university's Mary Lucretia Creighton Award for Outstanding Female Faculty, and I deeply admire her energy, passion, and commitment to the liberal arts and Jesuit education. She is excellent at what she does. A reminder in our conversation today that if you have any questions, to please add them to the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen, and we will get to them in due course after her presentation. But enough for me for right now. Without further ado, I'd like to hand it over to you, Bridget, for your paper, James Field Stanfield's The Guinea Voyage and the Problem of Evil.
Well, thank you so much, Joe. I hope everyone can hear me okay. Again, I want to thank not only Joe, but Michael and Mary and Catherine and all of the team who are running this tremendous series. It's an honor to be a part of it today, and I'm excited to share with you about my research on James Field Stanfield. I'd like to thank those attending, and I'm eager to have your questions and your comments at the end. So I think I'll wait to put up my slide deck, but I'll do that in a minute. I have some slides mostly because I have some longer passages that I'm quoting, and I would love for the audience to be able to see some of the language and the style that Stanfield uses, because that's what I'm going to be analyzing primarily. So I'll get started. In 1777, James Field Stanfield was one of only three sailors who returned from a voyage disastrous even by the grim standards of the 18th century slave trade. 10 years later, with the support and encouragement of abolitionist Thomas Clarkson, he would publish two separate accounts of his experiences. One was a series of prose letters, and the other was a narrative poem of over 1,000 lines. Both texts confront the challenge of representing the unspeakable horror of the slave trade in a way that would inspire political action. Stanfield's firsthand knowledge gives him his account a vividness and documentary authority that Clarkson believed would promote the cause. However, Stanfield was both witness and perpetrator, and his two texts exemplify the discursive challenges of that doubled subject position. What I'd like to explore today is how his two accounts navigate the problem of representing the atrocities of the slave trade and the moral responsibility of his witness. Although scholars including Brickham Carey and Ramesh Malapeti, among others, have examined the stylistic strategies of better-known anti-slavery writers, very few literary critics have discussed Stanfield's work in any detail. He has, however, been discussed by historians of transatlantic culture. Marcus Rediger and Emma Christopher separately identify him as the first common sailor to write about his experiences in the slave trade. Moreover, Stanfield was one of very few Catholics who contributed to the British discourse of abolition, a movement dominated by Quakers and evangelical Anglicans. Our current understanding of late 18th century Catholicism and the slave trade, at least for US scholars, has been influenced by the efforts led by our host, Georgetown University, to address their history and make reparations to the descendants of the enslaved people owned by the Society of Jesus. While the church made its position clear on the enslavement of indigenous inhabitants of the New World from the earliest days of colonial expansion, it was largely silent on the enslavement of Black Africans until 1839. As historians have noted, in Great Britain, some defenders of slavery and even some abolitionists presented the British engagement in the trade as more humane and thus superior to that of Catholic Europe. For instance, in his abolitionist epic, The Wrongs of Almuna, published in 1778, Peter Newby, who was a contemporary of Stanfield's, as well as a British Catholic and former sailor, depicts the 1655 slave revolt in Jamaica to demonstrate Britain's enlightened version of plantation slavery as superior to Spain's. Michael Tomko's brilliant analysis of the impact of Newby's Catholicism on his contributions to the abolition debate are useful for understanding why Stanfield might not have overtly called attention to his religious background. Although Catholics were granted some relief from penal laws in 1778, full Catholic emancipation was nearly 50 years away. As Tomko argues, anti-Catholicism was an integral part, an integral component of the abolition movement's nationalist identity, its Britishness being a source of moral superiority over the depraved corruption of European Catholic nations. Several of the most popular abolitionist writers, in fact, reiterate the colonial abuses of Catholics abroad and in history, according to Tomko. Tomko identifies what he calls a split consciousness in Newby's writing, a voice divided against itself, contributing to, quote, a national anti-Catholic movement, while Newby himself remembers and experienced persecution from that very nation, end quote. Tomko's reading illustrates how the poet's alienation haunts his text, arguing that the poem is, quote, a political allegory identifying the sufferings of African slaves with the repression of Catholics in Britain, end quote. Not only as a Catholic, but also as an Irishman, and perhaps more significantly, as a working sailor, Stanfield's freedom as a political subject was multiply constrained. His authorial identity, particularly as a speaking subject in the poem, however, is not so much split as it is displaced. And I'm going to share my slides now, if I may. And hopefully I can bring them up. Born in Dublin in 1749, Stanfield left Ireland to study for the priesthood in France. Little else is known of his earlier life. Historian Peter van der Merwe notes that the archives where we might hope to find records of him, either in Dublin or in France, were destroyed by fire and revolution, respectively. An unpublished family memoir indicates that he experienced a secular conversion in France and lapsed in his faith. Despite an education that included training in the classics, he found himself serving as a common sailor, an occupation with a relatively low bar for entry, but which offered opportunities for social as well as geographic mobility. He suffered the fate of many of seamen of his age, and finding himself down on his luck, doubtless a disappointment to his family, his prose account suggests that he may have been deceived by crimps and compelled to embark on the ill-fated voyage, which likely began in 1776. When both accounts were published a decade later, Stanfield was touring as an actor on the provincial circuit in the north of England, in the company of other well-known Catholic actors and writers, including John Kemble and Elizabeth Inchbald. He was reputed to have been a powerful orator, known for playing Irish characters, thus not abandoning his national identity. Furthermore, he was trained in different rhetorical strategies to elicit emotion from his audience, making his choice to write about the experience in twice in two distinct modes intentional and worthy of examination. As an itinerant actor, as well as a dedicated Freemason by this time, Stanfield had access to an extensive provincial network, and his writings allude to other well-known abolitionist publications, such as Roscoe's The Wrongs of Africa. An Irish Catholic, Stanfield was the object of British colonial oppression. At the same time, his occupation made him complicit as an agent of British colonial oppression. In his maritime career, he likely experienced the indignity of many sailors being taken against his will and forced to serve a nation that extolled the value of liberty. While Stanfield unquestionably had more freedom than a fellow writer and sailor like Equiano, his intersectional subject position as an Irish Catholic participating in laboring class employment renders him triply marginalized. How then is Stanfield's identity as Catholic and Irish relevant to our understanding of his strategies and struggles as a writer? By the time he published his accounts, it appears he was no longer a practicing Catholic, and he had been living in England since his return from his faithful voyage. While his children recounted that he strove to instill piety in them, as far as can be determined, none of them were baptized Catholic. That said, at the time he was writing the poem, he was part of a network of Catholic intellectuals. In both of his texts, Stanfield's occupational identity as a sailor, however, appears to be most prominent, as it establishes the authority of his eyewitness testimony. Given both texts' emphasis on the brutal dehumanization of the sailors, his vocation also offers a means to exculpate himself. As we will see in the poem, he and his fellow sailors become akin to tools, their bodies made instruments in the enslavement of African bodies. In both texts, but even more dramatically in the poem, even Stanfield's identity as a sailor is eroded as we witness the sailors rendered objects. Simultaneously, the actual tools of enslavement are granted human agency, operating upon the sailors to dehumanize the African captives and transform them into commodities, a cargo to be traded. It's perhaps fitting that Stanfield produced two accounts in two distinct modes that explore his doubled and ambivalent perspective as witness and perpetrator, object of colonial oppression, and instrument of it. In the interest of time, I will only say a few words about the prose text, and the focus of my analysis will be on the poem. The prose text is written in epistolary form and begins by noting the dearth of eyewitness accounts about such a significant trade. Stanfield remarks that, quote, an impenetrable veil has been thrown over this traffic for such a number of years, end quote. The self-interest of officers leads them to diminish the cruel and horrible conditions, while most common sailors either die or desert due to those conditions. Furthermore, very few common sailors would have had the classical education that Stanfield received through his preparation for the priesthood, which gave him the advanced degree of literacy required to write and publish. So I suppose in this very, very practical way, at least, one could say that Stanfield's Catholicism is relevant, even foundational to his literary work. Stanfield devotes much of his narrative to the barbarities to which the sailors are exposed. They are deceived by crimps and trapped into serving. Once on board, they are frequently flogged and subjected to other extreme and gruesome punishments, often for imagined infractions. They are denied adequate food and water, even in tropical climates, causing extreme dehydration and fostering disease. Even before they arrive on the west coast of Africa, sailors are exposed to such dreadful conditions that many perish during the first leg. Anticipating the reader's questions as to how the captain could allow such treatment of his workforce, Stanfield describes how British sailors are replaced by quote unquote hardy natives when they arrive on the coast of Africa. Indeed, his letters devote extensive attention to how the Africans themselves contribute to the support of the slave trade. Details of Stanfield's 8 months at a factory in Benin are not replicated in his poetic text. During his sojourn, he loses most of his crewmates to disease. Their suffering is of little interest to the captain, who carries on with, quote, every circumstance relative to the trade, transacting with as little interruption and as much unconcern as if no such people had ever been on board, end quote. He can do so because another British ship arrives with a fresh crew. The sailors, even more than the slaves, appear to be disposable and expendable, of less value than the slaves they are hired to transport. The captain's sadism continues with the new crew, and illness and abuse deplete their number as they sail across the Atlantic. Stanfield describes how fewer and fewer men are forced to take on more and more work, even having to recruit the enslaved Africans to contribute to sailing the ship. It is only in letter 6, the second to last, that Stanfield comments, and there briefly, on the condition of the slaves. As Redeker and Christopher note, for a modern reader, it is jarring that Stanfield prioritizes the horrific treatment of the sailors over and above those they enslave, blurring the lines between abuser and abused. But as Christopher notes, it was an intentional rhetorical strategy and not unique to Stanfield. She observes, quote, a sailor, like a slave, was losing status while creating wealth. The rise of capitalism did not always advance a free labor market, but rather yoked some people's non-freedom to its expansion. Sailors straddled the line. While seafaring was one of the first professions to be paid monthly wages, their liberties were compromised by the way they were recruited. At a time when the liberty of all was being asserted, and indeed should theoretically have been enhanced by the rise of capitalism, seamen were a group of men whose freedoms were systematically compromised, end quote. Stanfield closes his account, his prose account, by asserting that his testimony, quote, comes warm from a heart that has felt the miseries it describes and from a recollection that still smarts with the barbarities it witnessed. He is a witness, a victim, and a perpetrator all at once, although his rhetorical emphasis is on the first of those two roles. He focuses almost exclusively here on the cruelties enacted upon the sailors rather than the Africans they abducted. The experiences of those they enslaved, in fact, are too dreadful for words. Near the conclusion, Stanfield briefly summarizes, quote, but no pen, no abilities can give more than a very faint resemblance of the horrid situation. One real view, 1 minute absolutely spent in the slave rooms on the Middle Passage would do more for the cause of humanity than the pen of a Robertson or the whole collective eloquence of the British Senate, end quote. The terrible conditions of the sailors can be described, but the atrocities suffered by their captives are unrepresented here and claimed to be unrepresentable. Stanfield's poem, by contrast, relies upon other techniques to address the moral and aesthetic challenges of his topic. Poetic language and poetic license allow him to draw the reader's sympathies beyond the sailors and toward those that they enslaved. The preface to the 1807 edition, which combines the letters and the poem in one volume, explains that while the poem was written first, quote, it was, however, thought that as a witness of the enormities of that traffic, his personal evidence might be of more use to the cause than could be produced by any work of the imagination. He therefore twice attended in that capacity, end quote. Originally, the letters were envisioned as a, quote, set of proofs and explanations for the verse. However, Stanfield's advisors recommended that the letters be given priority and that, moreover, their truth be, quote, substantiated by an affidavit, end quote. The prose then claims a kind of legal standing as a, quote, faithful picture of what was once the practice of the trade, end quote. Because the poem obscures the speaking and witnessing subject, as we'll see, Stanfield supporters may have believed that such validation was needed. The poem, too, includes fictional characters who do nevertheless enable the poet to approach deeper truths about his experience. Historian David Olusoga notes that the early abolition movement of the 1770s and 80s invested in several strategies of political persuasion, all of which are significant to an analysis of Stanfield's poem. First and foremost, they focused on the slave trade rather than slavery itself, recognizing that, quote, the Middle Passage was the most deadly and inhumane aspect of slavery, end quote, and understanding the more politically and economically complex goal of ending slavery would be regarded as, quote, an assault on property rights, which were a near sacred concept in the late 18th century, end quote. Along with political actions such as sugar boycotts and petitions, abolitionist public meetings featured powerful orators to educate and move the public. Those personally involved provided the most powerful testimonials, whether it was that of a former slave like Equiano or a repentant slave trader, the most famous, of course, being John Newton. Additionally, these speakers often employed what Olusoga calls vile props, with which they, quote, confronted their audience with physical evidence of the violence always underwriting slavery and the trade, end quote. Stanfield's poem represents the sailors themselves as well as their tools as such vile props. Both are manipulated by perfidious abstract forces as well as by the poem's very real villain, the ship's captain. In the poem's nightmare world, sailors are dehumanized and forced to become tools, while inanimate instruments are anthropomorphized and take on human agency. Stanfield draws upon a range of generic modes and stylistic strategies, including periphrasis, personification, synecdoche, and allegory, to reveal and conceal his embodied agency in the events narrated in the poem. From the outset, Stanfield adopts the epic mode, enabling him to use the eye of the poet sparingly, primarily to provide commentary. After an opening invocation rich with apt allusions to the third book of Milton's Paradise Lost, that is the description of hell, Stanfield offers an allegory on the origins of the slave trade. It is a storm that gives birth to the demon of slavery. That demon then forges a tremendous chain with a range of human vices adding links to the chain, including avarice, intemperance, passion, as well as folly and pride. These abstract allegorical forces take possession of the tools as well as the operators of those tools, here represented as disembodied hands. And here's a quote from the opening. The sounding anvil shakes the distant main, forging with ponderous strokes the accursed chain. The attractive outfit claims each bustling hand. Confusion works and uproar gives command, end quote. The poem features two named characters, the first being the lovelorn sailor Russell, who is mentioned in the letters and who is denied the ability to marry his sweetheart. While his story is reminiscent of fictional literary precursors like the lovelorn Palamon in Falconer's canonical nautical epic, The Shipwreck, Russell's presence in the letters indicate that he was an actual crewmate. His story is complemented in book three by that of the tragic, beautiful, enslaved woman, Abieta, also torn from her beloved. Abieta appears to be a purely sentimental invention based upon any number of literary antecedents, from Aphrabane's Imowinda to the many versions of the popular Inkle and Yeriko story. The emotions meant to be elicited by Russell's circumstances condition readers to react with similar sensibility to Abieta. Unsurprisingly, the poet devotes more lines to Russell and his demise and the indignity of his burial at sea than to Abieta. However, as we'll see, it is to another enslaved woman that the poet grants the distinction of being the only character represented as speaking in the poem. I'll move to my next slide here. While many of the forces responsible for the slave trade are abstract and allegorical, the agents of the sailor's suffering are specifically named. First, of course, there are the crimps, the nefarious agents who entrap sailors. And I'll read from just another passage. Polluted dens of infamy they throng, with painted vice to raise the siren song, with specious arts subdue the unwary mind, close their limed web, their feeble victims bind, fictitious debts, false oath, undue arrest, crowd the wronged prison with illegal guests. Worse than the crimps, however, quote, the gloomy master, that is to say the ship's captain, views with looks malign their short-lived mirth and hugs the black design. Once the sailors are sufficiently out at sea, the master's abuse begins in earnest. But even here, the violence is displaced through synecdoche. Quote, beneath rude hands, the hapless wretches bow. Should the keen glance mark indignation's eye, struck to the deck, the prostrate victims lie. Or to the shroud ingloriously bound, they feel the lash in many a smarting wound. The torment robs the sailors of agency, quote, nor dares resentment lift the avenging hand with sunken spirits and a frame unmanned, end quote. Further starved by short rations, quote, a torpid languor seizes every vein and the soul sinks beneath the oppressive chain, end quote. This abuse renders the sailors soulless tools. And the first book concludes with an exhortation to sailors to shun the fatal course. By refusing to work under such conditions, sailors could do their part to end the slave trade. In the second book, however, the direct role and responsibility of British sailors like Stanfield is again deflected. As they approach the Guinea coast, Stanfield turns again to synecdoche, giving the ship an agency independent of the sailors who man it. Quote, and now the bark advancing o'er the main, drags her disastrous store of guilt and pain, approaches baneful, spreads her dazzling snares, her glaring instruments of woe prepares. Figurative language masks the sailors' contributions to what is to come. Stanfield further absolves them of accountability for their initial abduction of the Africans, repeating what we see in the letters and blaming, quote, the impious natives whom corruption's hand has led to desolate this injured land. These dire agents first rip families apart. That said, in his poem, Stanfield does not restrain himself in his general condemnation of the British and their culpability in the act of purchasing the slaves. His grandiloquent lines for this moment echo Milton's at the moment of Eve's fall in Paradise Lost, and that's what's on our slide in front of you. Now the sad purchase, heavens, my powers refuse, though truth illumines and though fires the muse, nature recoils and in her depths profound receives heart struck the patricidal wound. As the wan traitors pay the price of blood over the black prospects, gathering terrors brood, the guardian spirits look with horror down and change their song of peace to joyless groan. Epic conventions elevate the moment to a cosmic scale, to evoke sympathy, but perhaps to prevent the reader from pausing to ask why the poet did not more actively intervene, the perspective switches to that of a newly enslaved man. The unnamed man's attention, however, is not on the British sailors who force him on board, but on unfamiliar objects, quote, the vast machine of ropes, tackles, spars, and ponderous engines seen as racking instruments prepared for him, end quote. As the ship departs for Jamaica, instead of focusing readers' emotional awareness upon the suffering of the enslaved, Stanfield emphasizes the miseries shared by both sailor and slave. The ship's captain indiscriminately tortures both, quote, pallid or black, the free or fettered band fall undistinguished by the ruffian hand, end quote. As the gruesome inventory of tortures continues, even the master's sinister hand disappears and the implements of torture take on a life of their own, here in this next passage, ravaging the sailor's body. And that's that ravaging of the sailor's body is given priority over the torture of the slaves. Convolved in pangs, that reverend form survey, beneath the country's wars and commerce gray, now writhes his tortured frame, the scourges ply, and from the last the quivering morsels fly. Invention next from her exhaustless stores, o'er the bare bones the venomed lotion pours, whose acrid salts in searching conflict dart, with pungent anguish barbing every smart. Allegorical figures of disease swarm the ship to infect everyone on board. However, only Russell's sufferings are specifically described. He expires, murmuring the name of his beloved Maria. The subsequent stanza bewails the fate of his now dead body. His corpse will either become food for quote unquote briny monsters, such as alligators, if it is disposed of at sea, or if interred on the shores of Africa, devoured by tigers who quote, lured by the scent of morbid blood from the fresh tomb, tear up the reeking dead, devour the mangled limbs, churn the chill gore, the last avenger of the insulted shore, end quote. Although his fellow sailors feel pity for Russell as they sent him to his fluid grave, they are soon inured, further losing their sensibilities as they continue to witness, quote, shroudless bodies in unseemly sort, thrown frequent through the blood-polluted port, end quote. As with the first book, the second ends with an exhortation to action directed to politicians. Stanfield does not condemn the atrocities inflicted upon the enslaved at this point in the poem. Rather, he seeks to protect British trade by protecting the injured and dying bodies of the sailors. The slave trade must be abolished because it, quote, bears our fleets and widows half the isle, end quote, as well as destroying, quote, injured commerce and with blushless aim usurps the honor of her sacred name, end quote. Stanfield mentions religion only once in either text, here at the opening of the third and final book of the poem. Quakers, not Catholics, are singled out for praise. It is they who have, quote, loosed the fetters of the captive race and bade fair freedom seize oppression's place, end quote. These, quote, friends to mankind and delegates of heaven offer a bright example that could end the opprobrious trade. Although there is no indication from any records that Stanfield had converted, these lines demonstrate his recognition that Quaker religious principles are an essential component to imagining a solution to the abolition question. Such a solution is all the more important given the lines that follow. Here, Stanfield attempts to describe the conditions of the enslaved people in the hold of the ship, a scene elided in the prose account. In macabre detail, Stanfield relies upon Gothic trappings and paraphrases, goblins dire and insatiate fiends of disease attend upon the scene, and the embodied impact of these supernatural forces are rendered through multiple bodily senses. Not only sound and vision, as one expects with poetry, but also touch and smell. And here is some selections from that passage. Packed in close misery, the reeking crowd, sweltering in chains, pollute the hot abode. Moistened with gore on the hard platform ground, the bare rubbed joint soon bursts the painful bound. Nor can they turn to an exchange of pains, pressed in their narrow cribs and whelmed with chains. One long sad groan, the feeble throng unite. One strain of anguish wastes the dismal night. In the poem, Stanfield compels the reader to imagine the anguish of the enslaved as vividly as possible. However, as the torments grow more hideous, the human agency causing such suffering grows more obscure, displaced again onto an allegorical plane. In a series of paraphrastic constructions, whips and other implements of torture seem uncannily to act on their own accord. As one slave attempts to walk while chained to the dead body of another, quote, stripes from the sounding lash, fierce drawn, succeed to give the fainting trembler hapless speed, end quote. Next, describing the force feeding of the slaves, Stanfield writes, then flies the scourge, sparing nor sex nor age, stripe follows stripe in boundless, brutal rage. Then the vile engines and the hateful cause are plied relentless. In the straining jaws, the wrenching instruments with barbarous force give the detested food the unwilling course. Stanfield shifts from the general torments of the enslaved then to the agony of one particular figure, Abieta. Prior to her enslavement, she was, quote, among the vocal throng, the theme and mistress of each rural song. She is the object of poetry, but it is suggested also a singer herself. Her prior life with her beloved Quanmo is portrayed as an exoticized pastoral idyll until Quanmo is murdered while heroically trying to prevent her abduction. Now violently persecuted on the slave ship, Abieta loses her reason and her voice. Like Cooper's Crazy Kate or any number of similar forlorn feminine figures who populate late 18th century sentimental and logo-descriptive poetry, she would be a stock character, but for the fact of her also being a figure of the poet. Kept in chain, she has lost the ability to sing, instead uttering, and this is my last quote, sad strains of feeble melancholy flow, half-meaning fragments of recorded woe, in wild succession break the pensive lay, through the drear night and lamentable day, her sad associates list the melting tones and join each cadence with according groans. As Abieta's, quote, lovelorn ditty fails, end quote, so does she. Neither the figure of the poet nor her song can survive the hellish conditions of the slave ship. Can we read Abieta as a double for the poet? Her torture is inarguably worse than Stanfield's, but like him, her double marginalization as African and female parallels his as Irish and Catholic. And certainly the voices of both have been irreparably damaged by the slave trade. Abieta's voice and her song are, however, only described, not quoted. It is another woman's voice who has the distinction of being represented, that has the distinction of being represented in a soliloquy, near the conclusion of the poem. Having just given birth on ship, the nameless woman addresses her newborn. A version, perhaps, of the Mater Dolorosa, she bemoans his fate and bewails her inability to rescue him. Although Stanfield explicitly highlights these two stories as written to inspire his female readership to contribute to political change and continue their leadership in the abolition movement, one wonders if he may have been influenced by the Catholic veneration of Mary in his decision to feature not one, but two suffering females to make his point. Moving quickly to the poem's final dreadful scene, the sale of the enslaved people in Jamaica, Stanfield continues to anthropomorphize the technology of enslavement, the ship. Quote, in the hoar surge now dips the bladed oar, the crowded boat creeps from the guilty shore, end quote. Figurative language cloaks the sailor's participation, and the poem's final lines make a bombastic abolitionist appeal, suggesting an idealized alternative, namely enlightened trade, where, quote, Afric's reviving genius grateful bends and greets the boon the enlightened empire sends, end quote. The poet cannot be criticized here for making a positive case for an alternative imperialism, which was in his time a common argument even among mainstream abolitionists. Although no masterpiece, Stanfield's poem and the companion letters are significant, I think, as more than historical artifact. The text stands as a testament to the complexities of representing and doing justice to the 18th century Atlantic world. The voices of those whose national, religious, or class affiliation rendered them ambivalent agents as well as victims of empire have been submerged. While their voices were not drowned like those of the countless individuals they abducted and transported from Africa, they have still been repressed. As Marcus Rediger and Peter Linebaugh have argued in their paradigm-shifting book, The Many-Headed Hydra, by attending more carefully to the sometimes awkward and sometimes disturbing writing of men like James Field Stanfield, we better understand the contributions of those hewers of wood and drawers of water who profoundly shaped the world of global capitalism in which we still live. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Bridget, for a really stimulating paper about a writer that I think many of us have not heard much about. And that might lead to our first question, which comes from Michael Scott, who will be coming on at the end. He had a little technical glitch earlier. Do you have a sense what the reaction was to the Guinea Voyage when it was first released? Do you have any idea about early reception?
You know, I had seen some reviews in the periodicals, and you know, most of it really praises his political aim, you know, that he's supporting this humanitarian cause, but does, you know, I mean, as I think you can probably see from the passages that I quoted, I mean, the style is a bit overdrawn, a bit, you know, extreme. And so I think stylistically there was, you know, a sense that this was a little much, but it's a tricky, you know, as I said, I think it's a tricky topic because, you know, how to guide the reader's sympathies, how to get them on board with the cause was challenging. Again, you know, Stanfield is trying to gain sympathy for the sailors because they'll be easier to identify with for the readership, but recognizing that he is a sailor himself has, you know, contributed to the moral situation that he's describing. So, as I said, the few reports that this had really kind of looked at it more as propaganda, in a way, than a kind of literary achievement, even though it's a very densely elusive text. As I said, there's lots of allusions to Paradise Lost, for example.
Yes. Yeah, that comes through clearly. And I think, I mean, there's just sort of layers to the onion here about, that you've touched on quite deftly, I think, about sort of Black slavery put in terms of Catholic oppression in England as a way of kind of garnering sympathies, maybe across race, that might, to our modern sensibilities, seem a little tone deaf or a little bit like, I don't know if this is the comparison you want to be going down. But you can see how, if he's doing sort of a calculation, say, how can I, while both kind of exculpating himself or trying to remove himself from guilt, but also pointing to I'm part of this group too that's being somehow oppressed, even though I think the scales are really are really quite to our modern sensibilities. But it's an interesting tactical maneuver in his part as a poet and writer.
I will say too, I mean, again, you know, as you say, there is a scale, but I think anybody who knows anything about conditions, shipboard conditions, especially on slave ships, they were, I mean, the conditions for the working sailors were just awful. They were really, I mean, they were in some ways potentially treated worse than the slaves because, you know, the slaves, they knew they were a commodity that they had to sell, but the sailors really were expendable. And there was this sort of attitude, a kind of class-based attitude that, you know, these working class sailors, you know, we can do what we want with them. You know, we can throw them overboard basically because there's a ready supply of them. We can, you know, have more of them. And so I think there's really sort of a class issue too here that I don't want to, you know, I don't want to pass over. And that's a little bit, you know, hard to sometimes read in 18th century texts. And, you know, we know a good deal about, you know, when we think about pirates and so forth, and some of those rebellions, the mutinies, the piracy, the labor action really comes from just these completely inhumane working conditions on the ship. And you know, you can't get off. It's not like you can leave. You know, some of the worst of the factory model, labor historians posit, really came from the ship, because the ship is like a factory. You're kind of closed in, you can't leave. You're at the mercy of the captain or the, you know, the overseer. And really that master becomes a kind of god to you in a way that is in some ways analogous to what the slaves experienced.
You think this is a sort of a lead into kind of what Charles Dickens was doing and some of his fiction even?
Oh, sure, yeah. Yeah, I mean, as I said, you know, the you know, for labor historians, the ship is really an interesting model, because on the one hand, you know, it becomes this place where you see some of the advances in labor history, like being paid wages, as I mentioned, like the ways in which, you know, you have organized collective action against the owners that did, at least kind of as you get to the end of the 18th century, start to have an impact. But it is also, as I said, it's also a factory. You know, it's a factory. It's the first factory model of people being kind of put in a place and forced to work, you know, in inhumane hours, being treated like machines, being treated like objects as they are. If you think about something like Dickens's Hard Times, you know, where we have this dehumanization of people being made to be just sort of appurtenances to machines. And I think that's part of what Stanfield is doing in that kind of crazy figurative language he's using.
Thank you. Just a reminder to folks, if you have questions, if you just down in the little Q&A box, please do send those our way. And Catherine Temple at Georgetown will pass them along to me. I have a handful of questions that I'd like to continue asking, but I want to make sure we hear from others if they have questions. What do you make of Abieda? Is that how you pronounce her name?
Abieda, yeah.
Abieda, her inability to be a poet, to sing, because if I got that right, she wasn't forced not to sing. She wasn't forced not to be a poet, but she just couldn't. She couldn't articulate it. Is that right?
I think this has to do with, you know, the torment causing her to lose her reason, lose her voice. You know, it's so overwhelming what she experiences that she, you know, again, can't speak or can only groan. I mean, the kind of sounds and the words to describe sounds are really significant here. One of the only papers on Stanfield as a writer is actually a brilliant analysis of the soundscape of the slave ship that we see in him. So the kinds of, not just the music, but the noise here. I will say too, that we know from the historical records that one of the, you know, amusements often of the officers was, and one of the ways that they tormented the slaves was to use the whip to make them dance or to make them sing, to make them perform for them. So to what extent there might be something of that where they were, you know, expecting her to sing or her to perform, and she is just so overcome and so bereft and abused that she can't even utter a kind of comprehensive sound. I think that's really something to show that extreme. And as I said, you know, I'm sure there were many slave women on board the ship that he was on. But there's no mention of a slave woman of either, you know, either of the two in the letters. So that's why I'm speculating that these are these kinds of inventions that pull from a literary tradition, you know, that pull from this sort of sentimental tradition of the kind of, you know, forlorn female, you know, left deserted by or you know, with her protector murdered and then, you know, put out in this terrible world. But I think it's an effective choice because, again, that vulnerability that she has is more likely to cause readers to feel that pity that he wants them to feel. And I think, as I said, the letters really don't have much about the slaves and don't try to do that. But in the poem, you see him really trying to move beyond that limit of let's just focus on the sailors' suffering to make our case against the slave trade. He really is trying to move beyond that and to get some kind of sense of a fellow feeling and some sense of the humanity of, you know, the enslaved people, and seeing them as individuals. And again, he has Abieta being named, and then he has the second woman, the mother that has just given birth, as even quoted. I mean, Russell isn't quoted, no one is quoted in the poem except for her in this very, very poignant, you know, very sad address to her infant. You know, saying, I can't protect you. I don't know what's going to happen to you. No one, you know, this is a terrible situation. So as I said, I think he's doing some interesting things and kind of pushing the conventions of the abolitionist text that he inherits.
Mm-hmm. Oh, thanks. Yeah, it seems particularly sinister to either silence or to try to direct even the artistic expression when you talk about kind of using a whip to force people to dance, just like the things that produce joy and poetry and music, and somehow manipulating or silencing even those particularly sinister. We have a question from Mike Collins, who asks, the absence of human agency, which you talked about a bit, the absence of human agency is the description of the suffering of the slaves recalls, to him at least, a comparable style of description in Paradise Lost. Do you have any thoughts on that, kind of the
absolutely. I think, you know, as I said, this is, you know, as he struggles with this whole problem of the evils of the slave trade, I mean, where else to turn but someone like Milton, right, where you have a kind of apparatus, you know, this sort of cosmic apparatus to try to somehow come up with a reason for it, because it does seem so completely irrational and inhumane and so forth. So you'll see, as I said, and I chose a couple of those passages, again, that opening passage that kind of reminds me very much, that evokes the description of Satan and hell in book three, and then, you know, the sale of the slaves being, you know, like that moment where Eve is biting the apple. But the displacement too, I mean, it's Paradise Lost, but I was thinking the other day as I was revising the paper, it's a strategy that's kind of a late 18th century strategy in moral poetry. So it's something that if you know Goldsmith, The Deserted Village, for example, you know, one of the things that as you look at Goldsmith, I mean, obviously another Irish poet, right, you know, living in England and critiquing, you know, the disenfranchisement of the rural poor, you know, the way they're forced to emigrate to the terrible lands of Georgia. And in Deserted Village too, one of the things that's, you know, when I teach it with students, it's often troubling to them is, well, you know, who's to blame for this displacement? You know, Goldsmith doesn't name any names. Goldsmith doesn't point fingers. He says, you know, oh, it's greed, it's avarice, it's vanity, it's all these sort of, you know, allegorical forces that are to blame. And so that kind of way of, and in some ways, you know, it's a way to say that these are all of our faults. These are things all of us are guilty of. We all have vanity. We all have in us greed and avarice. We are all culpable. And so to that extent too, I think, you know, Stanfield is intimating that by pointing to these abstract forces that all, you know, that all of us can embody, these abstract evils, we all have a part to play. And I think that's very true in the slave trade. You know, if you were living in England or North America and you wanted to put some sugar in your tea, right, you were contributing to the slave trade. And that's why the abolition movement often would have sugar boycotts or trying to, you know, have people try to to avoid doing anything or contributing in that way. But I think there's a way in which he's saying, yes, you know, I as a sailor may have been culpable. I contributed to this, but you know, because this is something that these are you know, sins that any of us could commit, we are all guilty. We all have responsibility for this.
Mm-hmm. So in a way, sort of avoiding the I, you mentioned that it's in the epic form, it removes the I, but it also removes the chance for us to say, well, look at what Stanfield was doing. I can't believe that, but actually each of us has some complicity in that.
Exactly.
Interesting way. Somebody else asked, or I think it was Mike Collins, do you notice any other similarities between Paradise Lost and this poem? Because it strikes me there, is it an iambic pentameter as well?
Oh gosh, I don't know. I should go back and look.
It sounded like it, but I don't know.
It's a couplet form, so it's not blank verse like Milton. Okay. But again, as I said, I think, you know, as we think about English epic, right? Or as we think about epic in English, the real, you know, the one to respond to is Paradise Lost. And I was thinking to myself, you know, I because I work on sailor poets, there's a lot of Georgic writing where they're describing the working conditions, but Stanfield isn't participating in that sort of, we're not talking about the working conditions. They're there, but they're sort of accessory to what he's trying to do. He is trying to, even in 1,000 lines, he wants this to be epic. And so this really is a kind of, or, you know, again, a story that transcends a kind of particular moment, mm-hmm. or that he wants to transcend a particular mm-hmm. moment and wants to see on a broader scale. So I think, as I said, I mean, we could, you know, like I said, I think there's other places I could go through and say, yeah, this reminds me of this part of Paradise Lost and this part of Paradise Lost and this part. And certainly it's there. And there's other, you know, other allusions. Like I said, I see some Goldsmith, I see some other early 18th century writers informing him. He's very, very erudite. I think that's another thing that we can thank his Catholic education for, that he would have been exposed to a lot of different writers, a lot of different authors, classical and neoclassical at the same time. So that's something he had over many other sailor poets who did not have the benefit of preparation for the priesthood and training in the classics.
Well, that leads into a nice question from Bill Jones, a professor in the United Kingdom here, who's asking about, he's interested in Stanfield's motives. As an educated man, he must have known about slavers, and unless he was actually forced aboard by crimps, might he have intended to sail as a witness to this trade, almost in modern parlance as sort of a war reporter embedded with the crew?
And I know Bill very well. Bill is the foremost expert on 18th century sailing and sailor poets in the world. So very honored to have him here. And I was nervous he was going to ask me a question. But you know, that is, I think, there's so much we don't know, Bill, about Stanfield's life. And again, as I said, the kind of most we have about him, and this is something that Peter Vandermeer at the National Maritime Museum has shared with me, is a memoir, I think, not from his son, but from his grandson. Stanfield's son, Clarkson Stanfield, actually went on to become a very famous landscape painter and was kind of a well-known figure in early 19th century. So it was really more of a memoir of his son, Clarkson Stanfield, by the family, and then looking back at James Field Stanfield. So there are these enormous gaps. Peter has told me that you know, he's looked at the trying to go back in Dublin to find records. And of course that was, you know, destroyed by revolution. And then Peter went to France to try and I think he was at, I can't remember which seminary he was at in France, but had gone back to the French seminaries to try to find any record of him at that time and when he might've been there and what would have happened. And that was destroyed by I think there was you know, the revolution, right? We have to blame the French for destroying their records. So there's a lot of, I mean, that's an interesting supposition, but my guess, Bill, is, and I think, Bill, as you know, nobody, no good sailor would have gone on a sailor who knew what he was about, a sailor like the poet William Falconer, who Bill works on, would never have gone on a slaver because he had skills and he knew. Oftentimes the people who went on slavers were the desperate. So Russell, for example, was, you know, couldn't marry his sweetheart. He was sort of emotionally desperate. So he just, you know, went, it's like joining the, you know, the French Foreign Legion, right? He just went on the slaver. You know, again, he might've, and I just, I'm guessing here, you know, if he, you know, left the priesthood, left France, I'm sure his family was not going to support him. We don't know much about his family. He probably was desperate for money, and probably had no skills if he's been, you know, reading Aquinas for 3 years and needs to make some money and support himself. You know, it might be that that low bar on the slave ship, the very low bar on the slave ship, would be just kind of a practical decision. So yeah, that's a great question, Bill. And I think, you know, we might want to look at some of his other writings. He wrote, as I said, he became a Freemason. So, you know, he had this great passion for reason and logic and so forth. And that might be another place to look to think about what were his motives. But there's just a lot that's kind of shrouded in darkness right now, unfortunately. And, you know, I would love to find a treasure trove of his letters somewhere hidden in an attic, you know, that we could construct that biography, because I have no doubt his biography, when, you know, even more fully told, would be just as fascinating.
Thank you, Bridget. Just two quick thoughts, and then I'm going to hand it back over to Michael, because unfortunately our time has flown by. But the first is John Ford Drescher, who does 19th century literature at Georgetown, and who's presented with us before, just pointed out that I believe it's written in heroic couplets, iambic pentameter, which was still being used by Johnson, but was falling out of favor kind of around this time. So that answers that question. And to the point about the priesthood and his formation towards it, but not getting ordained, Michael Scott pointed out that in Irish culture, that'd be referred to as a spoiled priest. So it's someone who was in formation. So you can imagine there was a certain pall hanging over his head. And so wanting to get out of Dodge. And it would make sense then that his records for seminary formation might not have been kept up to date. So
voluntarily expunged then, huh? Yeah.
Yes. Before I hand it back over to Mike, is there any last word you'd like to say, Bridget, by way of what you taken out of studying Stanfield?
It's just been a great opportunity. I've really enjoyed the opportunity to present. It's helped refine my thinking, and this conversation too has given me a lot to take back to the piece and to revise it with. So thanks very much.
Thank you so much for presenting for us today. It's been a delight. So, and with that, I'm going to hand it over to Mike Scott.
Great. Well, let me start with an apology. Something technical went wrong at the beginning. So I hand it over to Joe. Thanks, Joe, for taking over, even though I gather people could hear me. Anyway, but it's always best to hand over to your co-convener if you've got a problem. So apologies for that. I was just thinking, you know, when you were talking about the dancing on the slave trip, the slave boats, you know, it goes right back to King James VI of Scotland, first of England, who, when he married Anne of Denmark, and he arrived in Denmark and was to travel to the palace in the snow, he had four naked black men dancing by the side of the carriage until they got there as an entertainment. All four died. This is racism going right back, you know. And as far as a Catholic Irish or a Catholic Irish priest, yes, it's true that they were called spoilt priests. They didn't have to be ordained. They just had to go and start, and they became spoilt priests. And I do know of one of them in the northeast of England who actually came to the northeast of England from Ireland as a spoilt priest. And eventually his brother came to join him, and his brother was shot for being a Catholic. It was no dogs, no cats, no Irish, you know. And that was that went on for a number of centuries, that kind of discrimination. So to be an Irishman, and I have to say that if my name wasn't Michael Scott, it would be Michael O'Reilly, because that was my mother's name. And I had an Auntie Bridget as well, you know. So to be a Catholic working class was to be the lowest of the working class, you know. And this is the kind of things that they had to do. I'm delighted that you've been talking about Stanfield, because he lived eventually in Sunderland, and that was the city which gave me my first job. So I was delighted about that. It was a great informative session on an unknown, but should be more widely known, poet and abolitionist. So our thanks to you, Bridget, for such an interesting talk. And thanks, Joe, for taking over right from the beginning, but for asking the questions as scheduled. Our next event in this series will be on the Tuesday, the 20th of April, when Dr. Rachel Creswell from Blackfriars Hall in Oxford will be talking about St. Anselm. And this will be a really interesting talk. I've heard her talk about this before, about Anselm before and his influence. So that's worth tuning into Tuesday, the 20th of April. Another event which you also might like to know is Free Speech Project at a Crossroads, the International Dialogues event in association with the Future of Humanities Project. That'll be on Monday, the 21st of March, when we will be discussing the attitude towards veterans and the way that veterans are treated in many countries around the world after they've done service. Please note that this will be at 11 a.m. EST, but 2 p.m. BST, as the UK will not have moved their clocks forward. Sorry, I'm just being told.
10 a.m. because I want to move it forward.
Oh, I'm very sorry. Yes, it's going to be at 10 a.m. EST and 2 p.m. BST because there's been another alteration to that. So that's on Monday, the 21st of August, 10 a.m. BST. 10 a.m. BST, 10 a.m. EST, and 2 p.m. BST. Got it, I think, because this is all to do with moving clocks forward. Our next China event is provisionally scheduled for Friday, the 8th of April at 11 a.m. EBT and 4 p.m. BST. There's a change to the original program, and we hope to be welcoming a distinguished scholar, Haile Ma, from Leeds University, who will be talking about Chinese theatre and Chinese opera. Really worth hearing about this. I was in China a few years ago and I was taken to the Chinese opera. I was a little apprehensive about going and I found it absolutely fantastic. And it was just wonderful storytelling. And once you got used to the music, an absolute delight to be there. So that's on Friday, the 8th of April at 11 a.m. America, 4 p.m. UK. So I'd like to thank those at Georgetown who made this happen, especially our administrators, Julia Murillo and Mary Gordon. Further thanks, of course, at Georgetown to Dr. Jack DeJoy, the president, and Tom Banchoff, the vice president, the global affairs. At Campion Hall, Nick Austin, the master of the hall, Joe Simmons, my co-convener, Sarah Gray, and Ying Ying, our companion hall administrators. At Blackfriars, Richard Finn, OP, director of the Las Casas Institute, John O'Connor, the regent, King Arona Gabnai, the administrator. As ever, my thanks to Maggie Scott, who's sitting next to me, for helping me through today's really adventurous technical stuff. So thank you very much, Maggie, for that. And finally, our thanks, as ever, to you for being part of the audience. Please join us again for some of the events I've mentioned. In the meantime, take care and keep safe. I'm Mike Scott. Please follow me on Twitter @MikeScottProf. Thank you and goodbye.